Grandma's little baby boy, I love you. Grandma's little baby boy.
Turn the TV on.
Here we are, November the 6th. Rahfeal is now 9 months old. Listen to this. Get down, baby.
Good morning. And how do you do?
Buenos dias. Buenos dias. Buenos dias. Usted. Buenos dias. Buenos dias. Buenos dias. Yes. Yes.
Guys, ready for your keynote speaker?
Yeah. Rahfeal, the stage is yours.
My name is Rahfeal Gordon. I am the CEO of RahGor Motivations and Publishers. Let me tell you about where I'm from.
Born and raised in Newark, New Jersey. I'm the oldest out of four boys. Both of my parents were crack addicts. My younger brother ended up joining the gang and went off to prison. The second one, Alfonso, was murdered.
So here I stand in front of 375 South 10th Street. It was the last place that my mom and my father were together with my three brothers and myself.
I had the opportunity of knowing what it means and what it feels to have a complete family structure.
But by the time I got into middle school, everything changed. I noticed that my dad was a little bit more angrier. I noticed that my mom was really stressed out a lot. She really wanted to come home.
So one night, it was a dark moment. Like, dad went crazy on my mom,
and he's wild, he's going crazy on her, and I'm running out of the room, and I'm in the living room, and I'm looking, I'm just shaking, I'm scared, I'm crying.
But my father ends up throwing my mother down the stairs, and the ambulance came.
She ended up leaving, and you know, he couldn't find her. So he assumed that we knew where she was, which we didn't, and he really got on us, and he beat us physically.
I have to get out of here because it's too much pain. And I remember around like about 1:35, 1:40 in the morning, I just wake up.
Remember me getting up and jumping off the bunk bed and I opening up the window.
I stretch my arms out wide and I say, I'm gonna jump. And my brother, John Vier, who's the second OC, jumps out, he wakes up, he's like, Rob, what are you doing? I'm like, I gotta get out of here, I gotta save us, I gotta go to grandma's house. He's like, come back into the house and let's go through this together. Like, we're gonna make it. Now, I'm in the third grade. He's in the first grade, because he's 2 years younger. He's in the first grade. My little brother saved my life. Right now, talking to you, saying that I told my brother one day, when I first told him the story 5 years ago, I couldn't even tell the story, because I was crying.
My brother saved my life.
And after my mother left, my dad came home and was like, listen, let me give you some perspective for you. He said, y'all gotta go.
My mom has left with four boys.
I had the opportunity to live in almost all the homeless shelters with my mother and my three younger brothers.
Around the corner is the YMCA. I live on the 13th floor. Go past Bear Stadium, Grant Street, I live in the Apostle House. Go up on Avon Avenue, there's the second Apostle House, I live there too. Go on Washington Street, there's the Lighthouse, I'm there too.
Over at the corner was a payphone, and my mom told me and my mother got into a major argument. You call your father. She said, I don't think your father wants you. So I called him collect, and he denied my phone call. And I called him again. He took it, accepted. I told him I wanted to be with him. He said he couldn't take me in. And ever since then, I realized like how much pain. I felt a lot of pain at a young age, and I was in the sixth grade.
And even though I was young, I knew that my brothers were following my lead because they trust that everything I did for them was to get them to where we needed to go for safety, for food, for shelter.
But this is where greatness is born. This is what greatness is. Again, I'm a diamond in the rough and I'm shining through all this. Yeah!
I'm a rose with no color, just black. Do you understand? Because it doesn't get any deeper than that. I grow up your leftovers. because nature there comes my way. I'm that seed you call up that has been thrown away. So I grew from out the crack of concrete, proving nature wrong. Black, beautiful, never weak, standing tall, firm, and strong. So I was born in the resemblance of your form, and it's not my image that scares nature away. So I live, learn, and grow in shape, proving nature wrong from day to day. So as long as you show me your hatred by sending me your unfresh water and unclean air, I will not die. For this, because it is your leftovers that help me grow. So forever, I will continue. Surprise.
The house that I lived in actually was right here. This is what it was like for me psychologically waking up in this area. An individual that goes through so much heartache, so much pain, and then visually see nothing but death and poverty. There's nothing here. It was just graveyards, the highway, and the projects. Is this where I want to really stay for the rest of my life? And for me personally, the answer is no. In my story, in my book, I talk about how me and my father got into this huge situation where my brother was left in the basement.
So, Father, put your drawers on and go to the basement. So, our father goes to the basement. My father said, yo, when I come home, you better be there. So far as I live, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, my mom comes past.
And I remember me and my father getting into an argument, and he pushed me to the wall, and I just blacked out, and I just straight hit him with my right, boom, and he fell. And I just started wilding on him. When I got myself together, they pulled me off my father. I literally ran down the stairs, and I ran like right here, and I just sat there on the ground like, I can't take this shit no more, I gotta get out.
My father basically took me to a crack house. I was a freshman in high school. I've been on my own ever since. My father left me in a crack house.
Because see where they came from, the impact of me being their aunt, okay, and having a blind side to the things that they were going through, I should have been a more stronger force in their life. Yes, I was there, but because he was always smiling, they seemed happy. I didn't question until I came into this house. My nephew will talk about this house that when his father took over their care. And I never went into the basement until my son spent a summer with my nephew and talked about this basement. And when I went down there, I was blown away. I'm like, all these years, this was going on below us? Are you kidding me? You know,
mm-mm. Whatever happens to you does not have to be the final say in what happens in your life. That you have the power and you have everything it takes inside your heart, in here, to choose whatever you want in life.
So here we are on Irvin Turner and West Runyon Street in Newark. This exact street is where I was in high school when I needed to make some money and I was out here asking for change. When my mother would come around in my high school years, she would ask me like, did I have money, or she would give me like $5 or a couple of singles. What happened was my mother gave me a shirt to put on and gave me a cup, and the cup was like wrapped with like some type of the name of a church. And she said, what you do is you ask for people for donations, and whatever you get from your cup will give you half of the money. It crushed me, but then I got used to it, so like the pride and everything was gone. How far I have come from being on this corner asking for change to now, you know, traveling the world, signing autographs, and speaking in front of thousands of individuals.
I seen this woman that sits on the corner. She literally just lays there, like two blocks up from my office. This woman always asks for change. I mean, she's a frail woman. She looks like she'd be as old as my mother. And people on Fifth Avenue can't even give a dollar. I can't even just serve her. It hurt me. So the RahGor team, including myself, will be going out tomorrow into New York City to New York Penn Station, Madison Square Garden, Port Authority, Central Park, Fifth Avenue, Sixth Avenue. And if you're able to receive, you're gonna be able, that means you also have the time to give.
Definitely try to follow Rahfeal's footsteps and make this way bigger than it really is.
The blessing that you receive is being the blessing of somebody else.
I realize that even something as small as giving someone a sandwich or a cake or a book, it could make their day better, and not everyone gets to enjoy that as we do, and we take that for granted.
Like, helping a few people is like better than helping nobody at all, you know?
1, 2, 3.
Portraits of Serving.
I remember living near Little Bricks. A lot of my good friends, they wanted to sell drugs, they wanted to hustle. I didn't want to sell drugs, you know? So I remember going to a store about 2 blocks away from here, and I purchased candy, and I would bag it up like they were drugs.
Everybody was broke. Raf came up, everybody one day was like, yo, I got this idea. So we like, what's up? We gonna go to the candy factory, and we gonna, you know what I mean, get this candy. And we're gonna go outside and we're gonna push this candy.
And I would go to my high school, which was Arts High School here in Newark. We have about 4 floors, so I looked at it as every floor was a street. And each street would have a product. And every day I would come back home, or to where I was staying, with almost $350 a day from selling candy. I was 15, 16 years old when I started doing that. A good friend of mine, he said, you know, Ra, like, you know, you were the candy kingpin. If you don't like where you are, if it's hard, if you want more economically, or you want to do things better for your family, even for yourself, create that path, create those opportunities.
Met RahGor, downtown Newark, when I was like 16, I think. He was pretty much the same guy. I mean, I would say RahGor is the same in high school and as a teen.
He had the same drive, you know what I mean? But of course, it was a younger draw.
I think he had flyers about Infinite Productions, and he was selling candy.
So he used the psychology, he used the strategy of what he saw going on around him, which was unfortunately hustling, drug selling, that kind of thing. However, he took that and turned that into a positive. So he took the mentality, the strategy, and all that from drug dealers, etc. And he created candy kingpins.
How you feeling, man?
Feeling awesome. It's going to be an amazing day at Hawkins Street School in Newark. So it's the hometown, so it's only right that I be here and be excited for the students, and it's amazing.
Good morning.
Been through a lot. Your life story encouraged me to fight for my rights. I am going to try to follow your footsteps. P.S. Thank you for encouraging me.
Yo, I'm like lost for words right now. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm lost for words. This part of the program made my day. The teachers here, the administrators here are doing a phenomenal job and doing what they can to make these students learn as much as they can.
I want you to get as much, and I'm gonna cry, as much as you can from him.
And if you come to school and you do nothing, you will not be as successful. And I want you to take his information, I want you to take his story, and I want you to try.
If I can do it, right. There's no excuse.
Here it is.
What a great example the world has, the universe has, of what a black man is, even coming up out of the ashes, as it were, out of difficult circumstances. He's an extraordinary model for our community of young black men who feel hopeless and uninspired.
Rahfeal's work is definitely significant for the inner city youth, because he's taking the steps that he needs to. I think he's a great role model for them.
My brother dropped out of school. He never went to high school, didn't finish high school at all. He started selling drugs, and he joined the gang. And I was in college at the time. And I said, you know, why do you keep coming back to these streets? You know, there's nothing out here but death and prison.
If you make it, if you become rich and famous, and if you make be in the movies or something of that nature, I'll stop. I'll follow you. And so I told our fathers, I made him a promise that as long as I live, I would do that. I'm going to work hard. I'm going to show him that following his big brother will make him a success.
I get a phone call like 4 something in the morning, who told me that my brother's been killed. I was told, you know, the dude came up and, you know, ran up on him, whatever the case happened, and dude shot him, like, you know, right up on his face, right behind his head. And he was really doing what I told him not to do, but he was doing it on a whole other level. His mindset was crazy. And, you know what I'm saying, left him right here on this corner.
The same corner I told him not to go on, he was murdered on.
My brother lost his life dealing with gang violence and just trying to figure out a way to be, to get support that he needed, that he was lacking. And every day that I live, I have to live for him and every individual, every young person that lost their life, every young person that's trying to find their way out, every young person that feels that no one is listening.
Rahfeal is a black male in the United States of America. And you don't have to be a blind man to see what's happening. So I believe his story, past, present, and future, can impact another black male to want to reach back and pull up another black male.
I don't want people to forget who we are. I don't want young black African-American men. I don't want my son. I have a young African-American son. I don't want them to forget who we are and where we come from and where we're going. And Rahfeal is that person that reminds us of that.
In our inner cities, you can't walk down the street because there's gun violence. There's people that will rob you, stab you, shoot you. You're gonna get run down on by a cop for just being black in the neighborhood at that time, even though you did nothing wrong. Like, we want change. Like, change doesn't start at the White House. That's where we're confused. He's just a figurehead, okay? Change starts in your own neighborhood.
And the pleasure of no freedom. But the days go by, and not the life go by, the life and the time. Try to reach out to someone you love, but you can't, because a man got too far above. Can't eat because your stomach is too weak. Can't sleep because your mom is too big. Wonder who will be on. But now I know the time is just beginning. Try to find things to do with the time. But you can't, because too many things are going wrong. You stressed out because you can't do no business. Because you're going to snap on somebody who was a coward. So now you're locked down at 23 even when outside. Reading books and writing books. Because you're back there, just look around. This is life on the devil's side. Go with your mom. Get right. Other side. Christ side. Who am I? I'm God of the person. You can't have a mother at any given time. God gave me a mom, so I'll play that with you. Who am I?
What?
I'm a leader. I'm the child of the king. I am the child of God. Funny thing is, I'm not a God in a situation like this. Sometimes I put his head on his stomach. I could have been dead or doing life behind bars right now. I showed that I never had to be myself. My mother had a father had fought for them girl brothers. Do you understand why I can feel so close? But still, God is not there for me. I still have a dream. That one day, I will make you know to give you sight of that man. And I'm there, taking you by the hand and walking the darkness to light. Who am I?
What?
I'm a child of King.
I noticed that that bubbliness was not really there, and he was pacing, and I knew something was off. And I said, Rahfeal, what's the matter? And he said, Lise, I just came from court, and I had to face the guy who murdered my brother. Now, prior to him saying that, all I knew about Rahfeal is that he was a big smile and energy. That's all I knew. And I just loved having him in the office. And I looked at him and I said, Rahfeal, what are you talking about? And at that point, he told me his story.
But when he came down to meeting the guy that took my brother's life, I was the only one that showed up. And my grandmother came to the courts to support me. And I said to him, you took someone from me that I loved. And for that, there's no going back. So I forgive you, because I can't walk around and live with a burden on my shoulders.
A lot of people probably counted you out when your brother died. Because that right there could take anyone out. But you didn't. It propelled you to say, no, somebody needs me. And I'm gonna keep going.
I'm glad what you said earlier today, it was the reason why we're here. Because I'm going through something right now too with my mans for 8 years. Just got shot on a block for some personal beef. So hearing your story and seeing you overcome that, and you out here on the stage with a suit, and you talking how you talk, and you successful, you really got me thinking for real. And I say that.
What really affected me the most positively when he said about, he looked at the guy who murdered his brother and he said, remember my name. And that's the same thing I want to do to right now. There's certain people in my life that I need to just tell them, like, hey, remember my name. You did that to me, but remember my name.
He makes me think about my son. We've always talked about my son. He was always very open and willing to talk about my son. Not that there were any problems, but just to talk about a young man, you know? Just to talk about a young man and the things young men face in life.
I think what happened to my brother Alfonso had a huge impact on what I do. We were just two human beings that experienced a particular part of our lives together that just, in a sense, felt like it was really tough for us. So to have him not around going through the process was a big toll on me. So every time I succeed or do something that changes a person's life, I feel like Alfonso was smiling.
It is his story for a lot of the students here in our school is pretty relatable, and for them to be able to talk to somebody who has been through it and has become very successful is very motivating for them, and it's just, I think it's really helpful and helps move kids a lot.
I really had no idea when I first met him about his entrepreneurship. I just, you know, knew that I was digging him and his energy when he came on as a Grammy U volunteer. And then one day he came over to me and he sat down in my office and he handed me this book. And I was like, what? And he said, yeah, I wrote this book. And I published it too.
He always had an idea. That's what I remember about Rahfeal. He always had an idea, even if that idea flopped. But to see him fail was even a success. Y'all know his life. He's been taking care of himself, and he's been taking care of his brothers, his family for a very long time. And he did it legally. I gotta say that.
For somebody to be that young and already have their own promotional company, you know, that moment right there is just something I never forgot.
Rahfeal was like, look, this is what we're gonna do. I got this idea. He's like, I wanna start Infinite Productions. So we looking around like, what are you talking about? So Infinite Productions. But he was trying to figure out who he wanted to be and who would take the journey with him.
His impact has just been, let's keep moving. Come on, we got a lot more to go.
If I had to describe Rahfeal in one word, I think I would go with greatness.
Persistent. Because he never gave up on his dream.
Energetic. He always has a smile on his face. He always give you high fives.
So on September 21st, 2007, I hosted my first seminar at NJ Pack in Newark, New Jersey. And NJ Pack is the sixth largest theater in the country. A lot of people don't know that. And I sold it out.
DJ Mike. Drop it one time, only one time. NJ Pack, make some noise. I'm not nervous. I'm just very excited because I was born and raised here, and I'm from the shelters, from the streets, and I'm here at NJ Pack. So,
and here I am, four companies later, 14 books published later.
A foundation created later. Two organizations on a college campus later. An advisor to world leaders later. An advisor to global entrepreneurs later. A residence in two countries later. At the age of 33, telling you that my location is not my destination. Are you guys getting what I'm telling you?
This right here, this is it, yo. It's just the start. You know, 7 years is how long? I could say even longer than that, man. I used to throw parties in my house when I was in the seventh grade. So you talking like at least 13. So anybody that helps me out, pushes me to go further than where I'm supposed to, or go further, as I was saying, help me go further. You know what I'm saying? You will not be forgotten, and I do this for you. I do this for all those that can't hear. I do this for all those who try, and you know, and to them they feel like they haven't made it. For these, for those who can't get out the hood. For all those who hustle for a reason. For all those that do what they do for a reason. It's for my brother. It's for my family. This is for me. I live with no regrets. I live with no regrets.
Dear Mr. Gordon, my name is Mobe. I've been through a lot my 13 years of living. I am away from my home, and at this moment, I've been away for 8 months now. That's how come I heard and seen you before. You even signed my book. I wanted to be like you one day. I have so many talents that I want to show and inspire kids my age to also do. I was really going to give up everything. I felt like my whole world was going to end for me until I heard you. Thank you. Sincerely, Mobe.
A few years ago, I had a student and he was having some difficulty with his home life and some issues. I keep speaking to him about Rahfeal and how he turned his life around and that anything's possible. That young man is a senior in college now and I still stay in touch with him once a year. So his situation also has gone from negative to positive. And that's God's grace. That is really God's grace.
We invited Rahfeal to speak to the kids, to inspire them, motivate them, to just do their best at everything.
We try to promote education and success in our school so that we can get kids to be as great as Rahfeal Gordon was. We want our school to be out there. We want the students to like be successful in life.
Team Rahfeal Gordon.
Turning the table. Sometimes we do the wrong things to get to the right things. Let's turn the tables. The question is, how what will be when you do to turn your table? We all have issues one day, but it's all about which issues you're going to subscribe to. Figuring out, is this going to be this issue that I'm going to read? Is it going to be about gossip?
Strive for like to give you the certificate of appreciation for helping making our community a better place.
Oh, no problem. Yes. What happens when an individual wants to become more than what society intends it to be?
One of my sanctuaries was my grandparents' home here in Hillside. The love and the support that I needed has always been here. When you have those moments when you get injured, whether it's spiritually or mentally or physically, you kind of get a chance to see who's really there for you.
Oh, come on.
you know, family is very important. And something that I've been learning and constantly learning is how no matter how far we are and no matter what we go through individually or as a family, that, you know, family, like, will always stick together. Awesome when you don't have to come for a wedding or for a funeral.
When you come, though, like, you'll bring, like, the random relatives that I don't even know like that. Like, Cousin Diane, like, she's like, oh, Ra's coming? Okay, we'll come. Like, you know? And it's just like it feels like family.
Yo, it's going to be crazy. My brother, look, we ain't played ball, like, together, like, maybe, like, about 10, 15 years. And you think you're going to beat me? You think you're going to beat his big brother?
And for my younger brother, John VA, who has the son, he's now able to, he's like, you know, you see what your uncle's doing? You gotta do it bigger than him. You gotta do it better. I think that's awesome.
Good game, man.
He beat me. He beat me by one.
Look, I can't even express to you how thankful I am. You guys are truly supporting me in the ways that I need to be supported so that I can do greater good in the world. Some individuals on my team will say, oh, Ra, you know, you did it, you know, you did your thing, whatever, whatever. And I'm like, no, we did it. So what happens is, in the stage of transformation, is what happens when you realize that, okay, I can get through this, and I'm gonna go see how far I can go, how high I can fly. You have to go all in. Take whatever stones they throw at you and use them as stepping stones to your greatness. Because when you recognize your power and you start to use it, things start to change in your life.
Just arrived in Oslo, so it should be pretty awesome.
Different parts of Norway, and get to see some familiar faces, some good friends.
Dinner tonight, which is going to be really exciting. 50 amazing global entrepreneurs and leaders are coming together. I am really excited out here in Oslo, and I'm just going to be heading down to the Nobel Center to take some pictures, and then I'm going to go around and get lost for a little bit. For all the people that have sacrificed for me to be here, in regards to those of my ancestors, those who have struggled for equality and for peace and for prosperity, you know, I'm doing this because I want to go far. I want to take advantage of all the opportunities that was given to me because of them. Well, I have a dinner with one of the amazing recipients of the Nobel Prize.
Really thank all of you for joining us here, especially thank my school head teacher class, Dr. Geeks, because teachers are my top priority.
I'm here at the Nobel Peace Prize ceremony. Oh my God, it's crazy. It's a lot of great energy. Everyone is full of inspiration. People are excited. People are talking about the historical moment that's happening and the fact that they're able to document and just be a part of the ceremony and history. The last piece before they go into the banquet. Everyone came out with their candles, and it's burning. And as you can see, it's quite beautiful. Hey, what's going on? You know, I'm over here in the center of Bergen, Norway, and it's super beautiful out here. This is very good. Down here in Mexico, and we already getting ready for Apprentice 2014. And I'm here to be one of the keynotes. Boom, boom, boom. Inspire the world. Let's keep it going. We got somebody out here that's 14 years old. I love it. It's a beautiful day out here in Monterrey, Mexico. This is it's a beautiful Sunday. Looking forward to another couple of days here and just, you know, enjoying life.
We just climbed a mountain. How many hours we climbed?
6 hours.
6 hours. You gotta conquer your fears, man. You gotta keep going forward, moving forward, and be at places like here.
I know what the fear is when I was climbing that mountain, because there was a moment where I started slipping. Like, you know what? This is it. Like, if I fall, like, so be it. At least I'm doing something that I love. And I literally stood up and just started walking the trail. And then that was the moment that I got it. Like, if we took the route that everyone took, we wouldn't be able to see this amazing view.
When you have an idea, a goal, a dream, you gotta make sure that you have so much faith and believe that it's gonna work that nobody can tell you that it's not. There were plenty of people that told me that I would not be as successful as I am. I just didn't have the resources, I didn't have the support system that I wish that I had. But I did not stop. Words have power. I am that I say I am. And how I project myself is how people want to receive me.
I knew Rahfeal Gordon as a student. I seen his transformation. So seeing him coming back and giving back as an alum is very rewarding to us as educators. Sharing his life and his transformation helps students change their narratives, indicates that they can change their lives, that everything is possible through perseverance, through education, through staying on course.
I could see the young men connect with him. I saw how they were hanging on his every word, and they walked away inspired and ready to do something different. And that's what an effective speaker does. Gives you the opportunity to hear the testimony, resonate in it, and then to move forward in the call to action.
I saw his article, an article about him in the Star Ledger. And a few months later, I was invited to a luncheon with the Newark school system for the homeless students in the city. And he happened to be the keynote speaker. I went to him and I said, you know, I love you. He's very humble. He's genuinely kind and a lot of fun.
This is my first time in Chile, and I want to make Chile like has like the most followers from a particular country. So being that it's like, they got like 600, 700 of you all that's going to be there between Thursday and Friday. First of all, let me just say that I am so, one, not only excited, but I feel blessed. I feel blessed to be here because I come a long way.
Yes. Hey, will you take a picture?
One, 2, 3.
Hey, you should tag me in a photo, and then all the people that follow you will follow me.
Same.
Let's do it.
Brilliant!
Oh!
Oh!
I like this.
Can the four of us take a group selfie?
Let's do it.
One.
I like that too.
Oh my god! Like,
thanks. You're really.
Here's a voice.
Just understand this, I'm good. I'm over my past, because if I'm not over my past, I can't get to the future. I love life. I will literally go somewhere and I have a happy moment. We'll be driving and I'll literally just bust out and smile, crack up, pull to the side. She's like, why are you, like, what is the problem? Like, I just had a moment, like, I gotta tell you about it. People say, you know, Bill Gates, you know, you're the next Buffy, you're the next Jay-Z, this and that, and that. No, my name is Rahfeal Gordon. There's only one man. You are needed. I don't care what color your skin, your background, your religion, your culture, what part of the city, what part of the street you live in. You are the answer to the problems within the community. You are the answer to the problems that we are in your school. You can make it and you will make it. The question is, what is it within you that you want to put out into the world?
Or just take a moment just to soak in the moment that you're here. There are many other people that may want to be here today, but you're here for a particular reason.
So this right here is, I think, a closing of a chapter, but I think that the next phase of my life is going to be something monumental. I'm already scratching on it. I would honestly thank my younger self for pushing through.
20 years from now, where do I see Ra? Whew, if I ever see him, he'll be all over the place. He will be, I don't even know what country, continent, wherever the wind blows him. He goes everywhere all the time. Definitely still traveling everywhere, promoting the message, helping people.
Well, first of all, it's not going to take 20 years for Oprah to sit him down and put him on TV on Super Soul Sunday and interview him for an hour, okay? It should not take 20 years for that to happen.
It's always love that follows Rahfeal, so you know if you're going somewhere, it's going to be filled with love and just, you know, just realness or whatever. He moves for not just himself, but he moves for a whole army, a whole movement that's behind him.
There's always this sense of knowing that he had, that he was going to be something. And I don't know where it comes from.
Every time I'm like, where are you at now? We call him the world traveler. Where's Waldo? Between him and that one in the door, where's Waldo? Because it's like, where is he at? Is he in Norway? No, I think he came home. Oh, he's probably going to Mexico? Yeah. This is a conversation me and Seppo. But these are the things that you want for your children in life, to travel and see the world. Because going outside of these walls, it's a whole other world out there. And you can't read that in books.
He clearly lives out his mantra that his location is not his destination, and his destination and destiny is almost unimaginable.
I think I can understand how he got that far. I can understand why he's doing it. It's the same hustle. It's like, yo, this is the next wave, fellas, jump on it.
Being around him makes you want to strive to be a better person. It makes you want to get on his level, you know, as far as traveling and seeing the world. And, you know, it's just like, it totally motivates you. Your location is not your destination.
For all that work that, you know, I gave and I put in, and to see where this man is at today, I appreciate it. And I want him to go further. I'm like, wherever he at in the world will be a big thing.
If no one told you today, know that I love you and that you're amazing and that you're beautiful. That's real.
Check this out. So I'm just arrived to my grandparents' home, and I'm super, super excited because I'm about to present my grandmother with my first official copy of Skyscraper, because she was my inspiration for this book. So I want to make sure she gets the first copy. So I wanted to make sure that I document that moment when I give her the book and just the whole energy, because I love this woman so much. And you know, my grandparents are so amazing. But you know, it's always awesome when you have like a grandmother that's literally always been there to invest in your dreams, to invest in just invest in you. So I want you to just come on, check me out as I go over here and inspire my grandmother. This is gonna be so dope. I'm so excited, so nervous. But like I said, like my grandmother always says, do you know where you're going? And if you like the things that life is showing you, then you know, then go for it and stay with it and keep going. So to all those who are creating something amazing in their life or trying to figure out if they should follow their dreams, from me to you, I'm telling you, go for it, follow your dreams, invest in someone, invest in yourself, and always remember that your location is not your destination. Come on, holla.
I wanted to give you something that I truly, truly is from the, I mean, I give you things from the bottom of my heart, say I love you, things like that. 2 years ago, I did something and I didn't know when to present it to the world. And so
I'm your world.
Yeah.
Oh, you said presented to the world.
To the world, yeah, to the world. Yeah, yes, you are my world. But I really wanted to give you something that people who receive this in the world will know that it was created because it started with you.
Oh,
and
okay.
So I really wanted to make sure that it was right. I really worked hard on it.
Yes.
And just for me to give this to you is more than anything. Like, I don't care if millions of people have it. The fact that you actually have it and I was able to give it to you today is awesome. And so this is just me saying thank you. For one, believing in my dreams when many people did not. I want to thank you for being my first investor in my company. I want to thank you for those days in high school when you used to take me and my friends when we started Infinite Productions and we drove to Edmonds to get all these cookies and cakes.
Lord,
and I was like 15 years old.
Now that I survived.
Hey, but listen, the fact that sometimes that when people, family or friends or whoever, invest in someone else's dream, it may take years down the line for you to see what that investment had become. So this is just me saying thank you and wanted you to have this, and you have the first of the many that will be created for other individuals to have.
Okay, remember, I'm 75 now. Okay.
So close your eyes.
Oh.
Yeah, I don't want you open. Keep them closed. All right.
Are you crying?
No, I'm not crying.
Oh.
Man.
So you still cry?
All right, you can open up.
Ooh, rah! Skyscraper. Get my glasses. Rahfeal Gordon. I don't know what it says up in there.
International award-winning entrepreneur, speaker, and author.
Rah! Your book!
Yeah.
You. Oh, wow. This is... Wow, this is real. I need my glasses. This is nice.
And I worked hard on it. It's my first.
Are you giving this to me?
Yeah.
Are you Thank you, Ryan. You're giving this to me, Skyscraper.
Yeah, the dedication page.
Oh, okay.
So this book is dedicated to my beautiful grandmother, Orlean Warren. Thank you for being a strong pillar in my life. Thank you for being a foundation for me to stand as tall as a skyscraper. For I know God loved me so much that he blessed me with a grandmother like you.
Wow, Rah. Oh, that is
it's the first copy and I wanted you to have it.
God is good. Remember that verse I taught you a long time ago? Oh my God.
But you know, it's I don't know, like I've every time I do things, I always think about the words. I remember the times when I left school and you said to me, baby, if you gotta leave school, make sure you come back, but make sure you follow your dream. School ain't going nowhere. You can go back. And I went back and I finished because I started my dream. And then you would tell me, have you seen Diana Ross? Do you know where you're going? You know that song?
Yeah.
So, that's my soundtrack to my life. And it's
where you going to? Do you like the things that life is showing you? Where are you going to? Do you know what you're hoping for? When you look around you, there's an open door.
Just letting I'm growing, I'm constantly learning, and I'm pushing to go higher. And I just wanted you to
make
you cry.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Like I said, I have taught you in the way that you should go. I have counseled you with my hands upon you. Psalm 38, I think verse 6. Oh my God, I said it so much, I'm forgetting it. But God, this is beautiful. God has blessed you, Rob. He has blessed you. I live to see this age 75. To see my grandson do something like this. He had a lot of young people back in the day who were really concerned with Rah and trying to help you to make sure that you got there, encouraging you, all those little funds that you had, missing money, clclosed doors, not getting paid, with some of those guys and gals. They stuck by you. Mm-hmm. I remember one guy, he sat down there on this floor, all the money you guys made, and he counted out all that money in nickels and dimes. Over, I think, $2,000 or $3,000.
Yeah, he was 16, 17 years old.
Yeah. You've come a long way. You've come a long way. And Grandma's proud of you.